Hello friends, good morning to all of you. In continuation of my lecture sessions on biochemistry for pharmacy students, in this session we will discuss in detail about beta oxidation of fatty acids. Okay, so in the last class we had discussed in detail about the basic chemistry, digestion, absorption and distribution of fatty acids. Okay, so in continuation of that we will discuss in detail about beta oxidation of fatty acids in this session. Beta oxidation of fatty acids, or otherwise lipid metabolism, in order to obtain extract energy from that food material, is one of the essential biochemical pathways which provides us huge quantity of energy. So before entering into the actual picture, so let's have a brief discussion regarding the history of beta oxidation of fatty acids. So this is the scientist Professor Frangino. He discovered the basic mechanism behind beta oxidation of fatty acids. Okay, in 1905 he demonstrated with a very simple and straightforward experiment where he used aromatic long chain carboxylic acids, where we have a benzene ring and a long chain long fatty chain is attached to that one. Okay, so by changing the number of carbons, so here it is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7, so odd number, here it is even number. So when even numbered carbon chains are used, so the dogs always give phenylacetic acid as a prominent metabolite in its urine, whereas in case of odd chain, okay, so it always ended up in giving benzoic acid. So this has shown that the carbon chains are cut down in even number, that to 2 carbon by 2 carbon. So this is the only logical way how phenylacetic acid can come as a metabolite upon degradation of this particular even numbered carbon containing aromatic aliphatic carboxylic acids with benzene as a terminal. So in this case, 2 carbon 2 carbon 2 carbon, okay, so this bond is not a CC bond, regular aliphatic CC bond, so that's the reason why enzyme cannot break this one, because we have a benzene carbon. So hence it will stop over here and it will go out as a metabolite, whereas in this case it can go up to this one, okay, benzylic carbon, so that this carbon will become COOH. So with this simple logic he proved beyond doubt that a fatty acid is metabolized in our system 2 carbon by 2 carbon, so that we are getting the energy that we needed from the fatty acids. Okay, so that's what he has proven for the first time. Later on, two very important contributors to this science, Professor Louis and Professor Leninger, these are the two great scientists who has furthered this knowledge by adding the information regarding the contribution of ATP, because they found like ATP is highly essential for the fatty acid to go into metabolism. Okay, here for his contributions, Professor Louis was awarded Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1970. He actually discovered the nucleotides and their role, ATP and its role in the biosynthesis of carbohydrates. Okay, and his knowledge, he further expanded the application part, because the ATP and its role in various other biochemical pathways. And Albert Leninger, he found actually ATP was essential for this process, and suggesting that ATP somehow activates the carboxyl group of fatty acids. And this is the scientist who actually wrote our Principles of Biochemistry textbook, which I am following, and thousands of students across the world are following, Albert Leninger. Further, Fyodor Linen and Konrad Bloch, these are the two scientists who has clearly demonstrated the mechanism and regulation of cholesterol and fatty acid metabolism. The complete picture was provided by these two scientists for which Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine was given to them in 1964. Okay, so this is the mechanism which they added and further concluded the entire beta oxidation cycle of fatty acid. Okay, so ATP dependent activation esterifies fatty acid carboxyl group with the thiol group of coenzyme A. Okay, so this is the critical step where fatty acid gets activated. So this is almost like one committed step for entering into beta oxidation of fatty acids. Okay, so these are critical junctures between various biochemical pathways, one pathway to another pathway. Okay, so this is the way how we now have the complete knowledge of beta oxidation of fatty acids and its role in biochemistry, human biochemistry, okay, because of all these great contributions. Fatty acids, because in the last class what we have seen from the food, okay, the lipids enter into first into blood via lymph, and then from here it will go to liver, and in liver actually metabolism happens. So in liver means what? So you have the cell, within cell the fatty acids are there, okay, in the cytosol. In the cytosol you have the fatty acids, so this is nucleus, okay, the fatty acids are there. But actually oxidative degradation happens within mitochondria. Okay, oxidative degradation means burning always happens within mitochondria, but the fatty acids are in the cytosol, so they have to cross two membranes that we have in mitochondria to enter into, okay, so to access the interior of the mitochondria. So this is the process which is very, very important for us. For this we have certain mechanisms like fat, because that is what we have seen just now. Fatty acid contains RCOOH group, okay, so it has to be activated, and with the help of ATP and then a coenzyme A are utilized, and then what you are getting, RCOSCOA, okay, acyl coenzyme A is coming, and then AMP is going. So this acyl coenzyme A is now an activated form of carboxylic acid. So now what will happen, so this has to be transported across the mitochondrial membranes. Okay, so this is mitochondria we have over here. Okay, now it has to cross. As you knew, the mitochondrial membranes means external membrane and internal membrane. External membrane is a little bit permeable to organic compounds selectively. And in interior, internal membrane is completely sealed. Okay, so that's why we always will have, because in total biochemistry in several places including gluconeogenesis, in Krebs cycle, everywhere you will see material transport across these two membranes. In all these you will find some kind of transporter system, okay, transporter or a carrier system will be there, which will help in crossing the material from one side to the other side. Okay, so here we have a mechanism, we call it as carnitine cycle. Okay, carnitine cycle. So through carnitine is an organic compound which help in transport of fatty acid from one side to the other side. So once it enters into the mitochondrial matrix, then here the fatty acid will be in a sequential manner, oxidative degradation happens, thereby it will give you acetyl CoA. Okay, so this is actually the outline of what is going to happen in case of beta oxidation of fatty acid. Now let's see one by one in a detailed fashion So this is the first and very important step we have. As I told you, the activated fatty acid will become fatty acyl coenzyme A with the help of energy obtained from ATP, as well as by consuming one coenzyme A, it will be converted to fatty acyl coenzyme A. So fatty acyl coenzyme A reacts with, this is carnitine. Here the hydroxy group, whatever we have over here, it forms an ester group. Okay, so this can be cleaved as and when it is needed through an enzyme action. Okay, so this is the simple organic reaction that we have. Now let's see the sequence of events that are going to happen in the transporter system. Okay, so here, as I told you, in case of mitochondria, we knew this one. Okay, outer membrane and inner membrane, two things are there. So in acyl carnitine transporter system, we have one long chain acyl coenzyme A synthetase. Okay, this is the enzyme where the first step happens. Okay, coenzyme A, fatty acid coenzyme A, is synthesized by consuming ATP as well as coenzyme A. And then once the fatty acyl coenzyme A is over here, this is carnitine transporter protein we have here. So that does two things. One, it takes up carnitine from the interstitial space, okay, intermembrane space, and react it with fatty acyl coenzyme A, so that coenzyme A is released, as we have seen over here, and then fatty acyl carnitine is entering into the intermembrane space. From here, the translocase, or otherwise this is what we call it as a channel like transporter protein, coupled with carnitine transporter protein, so that fatty acyl carnitine enters into the other side of, otherwise matrix of mitochondria, and this protein will break it down, releasing carnitine, and at the same time it takes up one coenzyme A, so that fatty acyl coenzyme A is biosynthesized and released into matrix. Okay, so this is the way how in a coordinated manner the fatty acyl coenzyme A that is synthesized over here is taken up by this transporter protein. So it synthesizes fatty acyl carnitine, which eventually will be transported into the mitochondrial matrix. So this acyl carnitine that entered into mitochondrial matrix will go through this carrier protein to will break it down to fatty acyl coenzyme A, will regenerate fatty acyl coenzyme A by taking up coenzyme A from here, and then it will release carnitine. So this carnitine will be transported back into the intermembrane space. So this is like antiport mechanism. Okay, carnitine is going in that way, and then acyl carnitine is coming in this way. Okay, so friends, so this is the way how first fatty acid gets activated in the cytosol, and then that will be transported across the membranes to enter into mitochondrial matrix. So in the mitochondrial matrix, actual oxidative degradation reaction happens. Now let's see. The process is relatively simple and straightforward. It contains only four major steps. So here you can see where we are right now. See, the fatty acid got activated, and then fatty acyl coenzyme A has been synthesized, and through carnitine transporter protein we got the fatty acid inside. And from here, 1, 2, 3, 4 steps are there. In the first step, it is oxidation reaction only, or otherwise dehydrogenation reaction, hydration, oxidation, thiolase reaction. Okay, thiolase. Okay, the four reactions are there, where in the first step we are creating unsaturation. The second step, unsaturated compound is hydrated, so that secondary alcohol is generated. Third one, dehydrogenation, so that oxidation is happening to that alcoholic group. Fourth one, thiolytic cleavage, means we are breaking fatty acid chain to generate SL coenzyme A. So this is the sequence which is going to happen, and this all these reactions 1, 2, 3, 4 they can be repeated till the end. Okay, let's say if we have 6 carbons in the fatty acid chain, in first round this will become 4+2, and it needs one more round so that it can become 2+2. 2 means 2 carbon unit, acetyl coenzyme A. Okay, this is the way. Okay, now let's see how actually it is happening. In the first step, as I told you, in the dehydrogenation step, you can see here the C16 acetyl coenzyme A. C16 means palmitic acid. Okay, this is nothing but palmitic acid, acetyl CoA. So here we have carboxylic acid unit is this one to this. This is alpha, this is beta. So here in from the alpha and beta carbons, one hydrogen is eliminated and that is transferred from the fatty acid onto FAD, so that FADH2 is produced. So this FADH2 will enter into electron transport chain, so that the FAD is produced again. And then here what is happening, we are generating a double bond. Okay, so trans delta 2 enoyl coenzyme A. This bond, whatever we have generated over here, is a trans bond. So this is the way how actually abstraction of protons will happen in this reaction. So as you can see, the protons are abstracted from opposite sides of the carbon. So that's the reason why the compound you are going to get is a trans enoyl coenzyme A compound. And this double bond, to this double bond we will be adding a water molecule. So what will happen if you are adding water molecule to an alkene? It will be hydrated. Okay, it will be hydrated, so that you are going to get an alcohol. Okay, so if you have a hydrogen here, R here, R dash, R double dash. Okay, so this is what we are going to get. But here, why the hydroxy group is going to the beta carbon? Okay, so can you tell me? If you closely look at the compound, so this is actually alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl system. So because of the inductive effect, you will always see that the carbonyl carbon remains positively charged. So that's the reason why in case of alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl systems like this, because of inductive effect, you will have delta minus here and delta plus here. So this delta plus will show inductive effect, which initiates this kind of ketoenol type of rearrangement. So where the beta carbon shall have prominent positive charge localized on it. So this is the reason why the OH, because when water is added, H plus and OH minus, the nucleophile will go to the carbon. So I'm just mentioning here, okay, you will not have OH minus, okay. So it will be hydrated and then proton is transferred. Okay, nucleophile will go towards the positively charged carbon. So that is what I mean by. So in this way, the addition of water molecule always results in beta hydroxy fatty acyl coenzyme A. Then that hydroxy group will then be oxidized to give us a ketone group over here, because this is a secondary alcohol. Upon oxidation of secondary alcohol, you will always have a ketone group. Okay, so in this way, 3 keto means beta keto carboxylic acid is coming. So this beta keto carboxylic acid will then go towards thiolytic cleavase. So this beta keto carboxylic acid will go towards thiolytic cleavase. So thereby, so it will break over here, So thereby you are going to get acetyl coenzyme A and the remaining fatty acyl chain with carbons minus 2. Okay, because we started with C16, now we have C14. Now it will again go to the first step, and then this cycle will again happen till the carbons are broken down to acetyl coenzyme A. Because we have here 14 carbons are there, means how many more rounds are needed? Okay, 6 rounds are needed. 6 additional cycles will give us a total of 7 acetyl CoAs over there and then 1 here. Okay, so that's how C16 acetyl CoA will give us 16/2, means 8 acetyl coenzyme A's will be released. Okay, so friends, so this is a way how beta oxidation of fatty acids happen. Okay, now let's see why oils or otherwise fatty acids are considered as high energy resources. So here in this case we have seen the fat beta oxidation of palmitoyl coenzyme A. So in this we are getting 8 acetyl coenzyme A's and 7 FADH2s will come, 7 NADH will come, because FADH2 we are getting in the dehydrogenation step, NADH in the step where alcohol group is oxidized to ketone. Okay, so 7 NADH and 7 FADH2s are coming. So in this reaction we will be spending 2 ATPs for the activation of palmitoyl for the activation of palmitate to palmitoyl coenzyme A, and then the oxidation of 8 acetyl coenzyme A's, because oxidation of 1 acetyl coenzyme A through Krebs cycle we will get approximately 10 ATPs will come, so total 80, and oxidation of 7 FADH2s will give you, if you calculate here, 1.5 as the ATP yield from 1 FADH2 through electron transport chain, you will get 10.5 ATPs, and oxidation of 7 NADH will give you 17.5. okay, so total 106 ATPs are coming by burning palmitic acid to carbon dioxide and water. Means complete oxidative degradation is going to give us this much of energy. Okay, but if you compare this one with glucose, one glucose is going to give you how much of energy? So on the other day we had calculated this one. Okay, one glucose upon complete oxidative degradation will give you 32 to 35 ATPs. Okay, if you calculate both glycolysis as well as Krebs cycle both together, you will be getting 32 to 35 ATPs only. Okay, so here we are getting a lot more than that. So this is the reason why we consider fatty acids as better energy resources than carbohydrates. Now let's see, because if you see the type of fatty acids that you will find in vegetable oils or fixed oils, you will always have different types of fatty acids, like unsaturated fatty acids will be there, and different carbon numbered fatty acids will also be there. Let's say if you have unsaturated fatty acids, how it will manage that fatty acid? Okay, so here we have, let's say when a double bond is there, because it continues to degrade from the carboxyl end, and when it reaches to this position, then we have two enzymes here, enoyl coenzyme A isomerase and 2,4-dienoyl CoA reductase. So these are the two important enzymes which help in the altering the double bonds, because in nature in the fatty acids you will never find trans double bonds. Okay, because the fixed oils contain fatty acids, even unsaturated fatty acids also, in all of them you will find only cis double bond, no trans double bond. So that's the reason why this cis double bond has to be isomerized to trans double bond. So here enoyl coenzyme A isomerase enzyme will help us in converting cis double bond to trans double bond. Okay, so then it will go to it will go to the regular fatty acid metabolic reactions. Okay. And in case of odd numbered carbon containing chain, sometimes odd numbered carbon will also be there, because if you see the regular fatty acid biosynthesis, that you will see in the next lecture, two carbon units are added. Okay, one means 2 plus 2 plus 2, acetyl coenzyme is the starting material over there. So then you will always have fatty acids containing even numbered carbons in certain bacterial membranes, and then some of the food materials, that there you will find a little bit of these odd numbered carbon chains you can see. Then when odd numbered carbon chains are there, so you will end up, because let's say when the carbons are cut down, so this is the 1 2 3 4 5 carbons are there. So when it is converted to, when it goes through beta oxidative process, you will get propionyl coenzyme A. You will always end up in having propionyl coenzyme A and then acetyl coenzyme A. Now this propionyl coenzyme A is converted to alpha methyl melanoyl coenzyme A by using this enzyme, propionyl coenzyme A carboxylase enzyme, which adds one carbon unit by taking from bicarbonate that is there in the cytosol. So here the bicarbonate that is there in the mitochondrial matrix, and this bicarbonate will be incorporated, so it will be converted to D-methyl melanoyl coenzyme A. So upon further alterations, it will become succinyl coenzyme A. Okay, this succinyl coenzyme A will enter into Krebs cycle. So this is the way how propionyl coenzyme A, that is derived from odd numbered carbon chain containing fatty acids, is utilized in our system. Then fatty acid metabolism usually happens at a fixed rate, okay. But if your system if there are acute changes in your system, like low carb diet or during fasting conditions, okay, so these are the two conditions where you will hardly find any glucose in your food material. So in that case, what will happen? Gluconeogenesis is initiated. Gluconeogenesis is initiated so that it supplies glucose to essential works for brain. Okay, but gluconeogenesis happens from one fatty lipid metabolism, where it provides glycerol, the 3 carbon unit containing unit, and the second one is amino acids derived from proteins, either in diet or otherwise in your reserves. In these cases, the gluconeogenesis provides energy only for essential functions of brain. Okay, but your skeletal muscles have to work. For skeletal muscles to work, you need huge energy. So that's the reason why the lipid metabolism provides fatty acids, so that fatty acids will degrade through beta oxidation process, so that acetyl coenzyme A's are produced. Because of increased rate of degradation of fatty acids, there will be huge surge in production of acetyl coenzyme A's. So this huge surge in production of acetyl coenzyme A's will put a lot of load on the Krebs cycle. Okay, so the tricarboxylate cycle, the enzymes that are needed for that are limited. Okay, so that's the reason why there is a possibility of accumulation of acetyl CoA in the system. Acetyl CoA is highly reactive, because it is like acetic anhydride, where activated acetyl group is there. So thereby it may react with any nucleophiles like SH group, OH group and NH2 group. So that type of functional groups you will find on nucleotides and several other biochemical molecules, functional biochemical molecules that are there in your system. So that's the reason why you have to nullify its activity, because acetyl coenzyme A is a very important biomolecule for us. So that's why we cannot degrade it, we cannot eliminate it, we cannot excrete it, because it is high energy molecule, essential molecule for us. So that's the reason why it has to be converted into a form which can be reused, reusable form. So this mechanism is what we call it as ketone body formation. Okay, so ketone body formation. So here acetyl coenzyme A will be converted into a chemical we call it as a ketone bodies, which can be used, because from where you can again synthesize acetyl coenzyme A, reusable. Okay, so this type of mechanism is there. If you have even uncontrollable quantity of acetyl coenzyme A is there in your system, then this ketone body may either come back and help in providing energy, or else it will flip and go into a pathway we call it as mevalonate pathway to provide us cholesterol. Okay, cholesterol. So this is the way how ketone bodies are formed and reused. Let's see in detail on various biochemical pathways that are involved in ketone body formation. So this is the overall picture of ketone bodies. As I told you, acetyl coenzyme A that is derived from fatty acid metabolism. Okay, so that will be two such units will be converted to acetoacetyl coenzyme A. Okay, two acetyl coenzyme A's will react with each other in the presence of thiolase enzyme. You will get acetoacetyl coenzyme A. So in the acetoacetyl coenzyme A, this carbonyl group is an ester group. This carbonyl group is a ketone group. That's the reason why this is the first formed ketone body. So if you have more quantity of acetyl coenzyme A in your system, then that acetyl coenzyme A further reacts with acetoacetyl coenzyme A at this carbonyl carbon. Okay, so this acetyl coenzyme A attacks over here, so thereby you will get beta hydroxy beta methyl glutaryl coenzyme A. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so we have carboxylic acid carbonyl group here, carbonyl group here, COOH, CH2, 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 COOH. Okay, so it's a dicarboxylic acid containing three carbons in between. If no carbon chain is there, COOH and COOH, this is oxalic acid, COOH and CH2 COOH, malic acid, COOH, CH2 COOH. Okay, two carbon units are there. This is succinic acid, and then as you increase the carbon, this is glutaric acid. Okay, so glutaric acid, this is alpha position, this is beta position. On the beta position, you have one hydroxy group, one methyl group. So that's the reason why beta hydroxy beta methyl glutaryl coenzyme A. Okay, so this is the name, this is the way how it got its name, HMG, coenzyme A. This is a coenzyme A. Now this HMG CoA will provide us acetyl coenzyme A as and when it is needed with the help of the enzyme we call it as HMG CoA lyase, which will produce acetoacetyl CoA and then acetyl coenzyme A, which can degrade it over here so that it can reproduce acetoacetyl coenzyme A. So here, if you see this reaction is almost similar to Claisen condensation type of reaction, where activated methylene group is adding across the C double bond O, carbonyl carbon. So that reaction is actually a reversible reaction. So in the presence of an enzyme, that process is facilitated so that acetyl coenzyme A can be regenerated and acetoacetate is actually produced. So this is actually the ketone body. We call it as a ketone body. And that acetoacetate will further get degraded by decarbonylation. It will give us acetone. Acetone is the final degraded product which also contained a ketone group. Acetoacetate can also be reduced to beta hydroxybutyric acid with the help of beta hydroxybutyrate dehydrogenase enzyme. Ketone bodies are produced in the fasting condition. In case of fasting condition, very low glucose levels will be there. Very low glucose levels will be there. So which organ actually feeds on glucose? Your brain. Okay, brain cannot make use of beta oxidation of fatty acids because fatty acids cannot enter into brain through blood brain barrier. It cannot allow fatty acids to directly enter into brain. Okay, so brain has to feed on only glucose or else the ketone body. Now let's see in brain how actually the ketone bodies can be utilized for providing energy. So the beta hydroxybutyrate we got over here, so that will be converted to acetoacetate. So this acetoacetate will be converted to acetoacetyl coenzyme A with the help of succinyl coenzyme A, and then this acetoacetyl coenzyme A will be degraded by thiolase enzyme. So this thiolase you will not find in the liver. Okay, liver it will not be there. Only it is available only in brain. So this thiolase enzyme converts acetoacetyl coenzyme A to acetyl coenzyme A. So it can it has the capability to extract all acetyl coenzyme A's from the ketone bodies. Whereas in case of liver, here you can see HMG-CoA. Only from HMG-CoA it can extract acetyl coenzyme A to provide acetoacetate molecule. So this acetoacetate molecule is getting converted to beta hydroxybutyrate. So this beta hydroxybutyrate goes into brain. So that will be acetoacetate is regenerated from acetoacetate through the help of beta ketoacyl coenzyme A transferase. It will be converted to acetoacetyl coenzyme A. So this acetoacetyl coenzyme A will be degraded to acetyl coenzyme A. 2 units of acetyl CoA will come with the help of thiolase enzyme. Okay. So friends, this is the way how ketone body formation helps us in providing energy to brain. So what is the problem with ketone bodies then? The ketone bodies, because let's say if you take this one or this one, we have carboxylic acid over here. And the second one is here, you can always have ketoenol tautomerism. So thereby this also provides protons towards pH. Okay, so because of these two, pH of blood may alter. Usually blood pH stays on the alkaline side. Okay, alkaline side. So this is essential for maintaining blood oxygen carbon dioxide proportions. Okay, so whenever the pH, if it alters, the carbon dioxide levels will be altered so that carbonic anhydrase can convert carbon dioxide to carbonic acid or otherwise bicarb ion. Okay, bicarbonates are synthesized by carbonic anhydrase enzyme. So in that way the pH will be strictly maintained. But because of the ketone bodies, because fatty acids when they are metabolized, so huge quantity of acetyl ketone bodies are produced. So that may fluctuate blood pH so that ketoacidosis will come. Ketoacidosis. In acidic pH, carbon dioxide's solubility in blood will be very, very less. So what will happen? So let's say if you take your lungs, okay? So oxygen is going inside and then carbon dioxide is going outside. So when you are breathing in, gas exchange has to happen. But when blood pH is towards the acidic side, all the carbon dioxide that we have is actually gushing outside. Okay, so much of carbon dioxide is going outside. It is as if your body is like a leaking balloon. Okay, so much of gas is going outside. So that will prevent oxygen to enter into your system. So thereby the patient may suffer from asphyxia like condition. Okay, oxygen cannot be there, he cannot breathe in. So this kind of condition will come, which may usually lead to fatality. So the ketoacidosis is one of the major problems with which patient may suffer because of uncontrollable ketone body formation. Especially this kind of situation arises in case of uncontrolled diabetes. Okay, where because of lack of insulin, tissues may suffer from lack of glucose. So thereby they initiate fatty acid metabolism, which leads to ketoacidosis. In uncontrolled diabetes, you will see that. Okay, so friends, this is the information regarding ketone body formation. They are an excellent mechanism for buffering. Okay, so when so many acetyl coenzymes are there, we don't want to get rid of them, so that we can convert them to a form from where we can easily recover our acetyl coenzyme. But if it is, it happens naturally, but when it happens in a very large proportions, in case of fasting condition or otherwise in case of uncontrollable diabetes or otherwise when somebody is on keto diet, in all these cases you will find ketone body formation. Okay, so they are useful to you because they are alternate energy source for your brain. But the problem with them is when their contribution to pH is significant, then it may lead to systemic acidosis. Okay. To summarize, the fatty acids are an excellent energy resources because they can provide huge quantity of energy on molar ratio. Okay. So when you take carbohydrates, they are giving you acetyl coenzyme because 6 carbon unit containing glucose is providing two carbon unit containing coenzymes, means we are losing 2 carbons. Whereas in case of fatty acids, in palmitic acid we have seen 16 carbon containing the palmitic acid is giving us 8 coenzymes, acetyl coenzymes. That means no carbon loss, no loss of carbon is there. So in that way they can act as high efficient fuel. The further, the acetyl coenzymes can directly enter into citrate cycle, so thereby you can get the energy. If the acetyl coenzymes are very high in proportion, they may go towards ketone bodies, which are going to be useful to you for running your brain in the absence of glucose. Okay, because when glucose is not there, because your brain is not trained to use other chemicals like amino acids or otherwise fatty acids for as energy resource, so that's the reason why it has to feed on glucose. So the only alternative we have is ketone body, where thiolase enzyme can convert acetoacetyl coenzyme to acetyl coenzyme. Okay friends, so this is the way how fatty acid metabolism helps us gain so much of energy. I hope you understood the mechanisms and chemistry behind it and the logic, actual logic that is there in the in obtaining energy, okay, in the entire process. So I request you to please share this video with your friends, and I thank you for your time and patient listening. I'll meet you again with another very interesting lecture. Thank you.